This is a word for you. It's so good to be in your homes today and to be sharing the Word of God with you. I can't help but remember when Wendy and I first began to tithe. We gave our life to Jesus, and really our parents had taught us to tithe. But as we first got married, we thought, well, we don't have enough money to tithe. And so we just quit. Well, we just moved into a house. We didn't have very much money, two little children, no furniture in the home. And the very first thing that happened in that new home was a water pipe broke. Instead of it costing us $183, which was what my tithe would have been, it cost $450. What a surprise. I suddenly realized that the Word of God is true, that when we tithe, God will rebuke the devourer for our sake. I want to encourage you as you watch today to remember that God deals with our enemies. When we're unable to deal with the enemy of poverty that comes against us, it is God that'll deal with poverty. Poverty is a terrible thing. Jesus said the Spirit of the Lord is upon him, and the very first thing he said he would do was he would preach the gospel to the poor. You see, when you're poor, all options are taken away. When you're poor, you're unable to get an education. When you're poor, you're unable to do better in your position in life. When you're poor, you cannot get a motor car so that you can go to church. When you're poor, everything seems to go wrong. I think of a poor man that was in our church in the city of Johannesburg. And this gentleman believed that if he would tithe and give to God, that God would give him a miracle. And so he began to give to God consistently, 1/10 of everything that God gave to him. It was during the late 70s, and there was a huge fuel embargo. Everybody was selling their big motor cars, and he too was an individual that had to walk to church or ride a bus. He never had a car. And so he would get up every Sunday and say, I just want to thank God that he's rebuked the devourer for my sake. I want to thank God that as I tithe, he's going to give back to me good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. And so each night when he got home, he would take his dining room chairs and place them out, 3 in the front, 3 at the back. He'd tell his wife, come sit down next to me. She'd sit next to him, and then his daughter and his other children in the back. And as they'd sit there, he would say to his wife, tonight we're going to thank God for the motor car. So each night they would sit down after dinner and thank God for the motor car. Then he'd come to church on Sunday, and people would say to him, well, how's it going, brother? He'd say, well, I just want to thank God that I believe that I received a motor car. When I tithe, God rebuked poverty off my life, and I believe God has given me a car. Well, it wasn't long, and he was attending an auction. They were selling off some of these big motor cars because there was no fuel. And on the auction, a Jaguar was being sold. The auctioneer tried to sell the Jaguar, brand new, only had about 8,000 miles on it, and he couldn't even get $3,000 for it. Eventually, the highest bid was $800. He said, before I give this car away, who is the oldest man here? It just happened to be this man from the church. He raised his hand. He pulled out his identity, proved that he was the oldest man. And the gentleman who was the auctioneer said, sir, before I give the car away, I'm going to give it to you. And so that Sunday, he came to church in a brand new car, only 8,000 miles, a Jaguar. You see, he exercised his faith because he believed when you tithe, God rebukes the devourer for your sake. So I want to encourage you today, if you have your Bibles, if you would open your scripture with me to the book of Genesis, to Genesis chapter 14, verse 21. If you have your Bibles, just open it up and have a look. It's the story of Abraham. And Abraham, the Bible tells me, had a nephew, and the nephew and his family had got into a whole lot of trouble. They'd moved to the city of Sodom, and in that city, they had fallen captive to a group of enemy kings. These enemy kings had governed the region for 13 years. It's interesting that 13 is a demonic number in Scripture. Some say it's a biblical number, but it's a demonic number, generally speaking. And so after 13 years, the city comes under attack. Lot and his family are captured, and Abraham arms his own household, leads them to war, brings them back. And when he brings them back, the Bible says he came and he met with Melchizedek. Melchizedek, the Bible tells us, was the king of Salem. He brought out bread and wine, and he blessed Abraham. And in verse 21 we read, "And the king of Sodom said unto Abraham, give me the persons, but take the goods for yourself." And in verse 22 it says, "And Abraham said to the king of Sodom, I have lifted up my hand unto the Lord, the Most High God, the possessor of heaven and earth." And this was his confession in verse 20. It says, "And blessed be the Most High God, which delivered the enemies into your hands, and he gave a tithe of all." You notice in this passage that Abraham made a declaration. He said, when it comes to prosperity, the only way out of poverty is to lift your hand to God and to believe God to bring you out of poverty. You need to realize that many times people who are in poverty are too proud to receive. People who are too wealthy many times are conceited because their wealth deceives them. Many hide in all kinds of fortresses. The educated man hides in his intellect. The wealthy man hides in his finance. The poor man hides in his poverty and says there is no way out. But Abraham said, I've lifted my hand to God, the possessor of heaven and earth. If God possesses heaven and earth, my friend, can't he meet your need today? I believe he can, and he wants to. So the first thing we read about tithing is that Abraham tithed in verse 20 because he recognized that when you tithe, God delivers the enemies into your hands. I don't know what enemy you're facing today, but when you tithe, you bring 10% of all of the increase that God gives to you. Then God turns the battle on your enemies, turns things around, turns the sickness around, turns the poverty around, turns the heartache around. When you say, God, the only way of proving my covenant is to give you a gift, then the Bible says the very first thing he does is he deals with your enemies. Now, there are many who argue about tithing, so let's answer a few questions. Some say that tithing was a law, or it's under the law. But you will notice that Abraham was a man of faith. Before the law ever existed, it says Abraham walked by faith. And we too walk by faith. Faith is that ability to trust in the promises of God. Faith says, God, if you said it, I believe it, and that settles it. Faith says, if God is for me, who can be against me? Faith says, I believe that if I tithe, he will rebuke the devourer for my sake. Faith looks beyond the problem and looks to the problem solver. And so Abraham is a man of faith. There are others who say, well, that's fine. But then after Abraham, tithing became a law. And yes, it did. But you will notice in Romans chapter 3, and again, if you have your Bibles, turn to it in Romans 3 verse 31. The Bible says, do we then nullify the law by faith? Not at all. It says we establish the law. Yes, Jesus came to fulfill the law and the prophets in terms of all the sacrificial laws, all the animal sacrifices, because he was the Lamb of God. But he's never, ever removed the Ten Commandments. He's never, ever changed, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not commit adultery. He's never, ever changed many of the laws that he established in the Old Testament. And one of them that he reestablished in the New Testament was to bring your tithes and your offerings and give them to the Lord. Well, then there are others who argue and say, well, Jesus never told us to tithe. Well, when you look through the scriptures, Jesus spoke to the scribes and the Pharisees, and he said, you tithe of mint and rue and everything you have, you're tithing. You're bringing 10%. But you've forgotten the weightier matters, justice, mercy, and faith. He says, you've forgotten to treat people right. You've forgotten to show mercy and to forgive. You've forgotten to walk by faith and not by sight. Your tithing has become an act of works and not an act of love. You see, we don't tithe because we're forced to. We tithe because God is dealing with our enemies. And so Jesus looked at his disciples and at the scribes and Pharisees, and he says, all of these things you should have done and not forgotten, to have shown mercy and faithfulness and justice. And on top of that, you should tithe. You will notice in Galatians 3, verse 29, the Bible says, and if you are Christ's, you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Well, the promise to Abraham was that he would be fruitful, that he would multiply, that he would increase, that in him all the nations of the earth would be blessed. God wants to bless you so that he can bless others. If you're poor, you can't help the poor. And that's why God wants to bring you out of poverty. Because when he brings you out of poverty, he gives you enough to meet your need, and then there's some left over to bless someone else with that gift. I'm reminded of a young man who came into the church not too long ago, and he made up his mind that he would tithe, hopelessly in debt, no way out. And one Sunday morning, I walked up and prophesied to him that God was going to deliver him and he'd be debt free. He shared with me, he said, you know, I came every Sunday, and even when it was impossible to give and impossible to tithe, I still tithed. I gave to God. And he said, God gave me a miracle. I had a property that I couldn't sell. And he said, something happened. A realtor came to me and said, I have a buyer for this impossible situation. He said, the house was near a road. Everything was noisy. Nobody was interested. But that realtor came with a buyer, and the house sold. And in a matter of weeks, he was debt-free. Today, his business is prospering. You see, if you're Christ's, you're Abraham's seed. The same blessing that was on Abraham is on you. And the Bible tells us that Abraham was wealthy enough to have his own army, wealthy enough to clothe and feed his own army, wealthy enough to go and deliver his family from an enemy attack. Now, the Bible tells me that the reason Abraham had such great confidence was because he had a covenant. You will notice if you look back in your scriptures into Genesis chapter 13, God made a promise to Abraham. Go back, if you would, to Genesis 13, verse 14. God said to Abraham, all the land I will give you and your seed. You see, it's God's will to give you all the land and to give it to your children. And so when he writes, and when the writer writes in the book of Hebrews, in Hebrews chapter 7, he writes about the faith of Abraham. Take your Bible and turn to Hebrews 7, verse 1. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 1. And I'm reading from the King James Bible. It says, for this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abraham after returning from the slaughter of the kings, blessed him. It says, to whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all. First being interpreted, the king of Salem, and after that also the king of Salem, which is the king of peace. Without father, without mother, without descendants, neither having beginning of days, nor end of life. The scripture continues to tell us that this king of Salem, who is like unto Melchizedek, is even Jesus. And so as I read through this passage, it says Abraham brought a tenth part to him. Well, then down in verse 8, I notice it says, in this particular case, if we continue to read, he says, and here men died, received tithes, but there he receives them of whom it witnesses he ever lives. My friend, you need to understand that when you tithe, you're not giving to a man. You're bringing it to your heavenly Melchizedek. You're bringing your tithe to Jesus. Verse 8 of Hebrews says, on earth, they used to bring tithes to men who died. But now, we bring tithes to Jesus, who ever lives to make intercession for us. Now, we bring our tithes to our heavenly Father, and he will defeat the enemies for our sake. And so I want to encourage you that as you tithe, bring your tithe. Don't bring it as you were to a man. Don't bring it as you were to a church. But when you bring your tithe, say, Father, I'm bringing this 10% of the increase that I've made to you. I'm giving it to you, and I thank you that you'll prosper the seed that I sow.